Hi, and welcome to today's webcast. I'm Professor Kenny Tepp, and today we're talking about stellar evolution, which is the evolution, the life and death of a star. A star much like our own sun. Indeed, about 4.5 to 5.5 billion years ago, our own sun was created. And through that process, it evolves, it goes through its own lifespan, and in about another 4.5 to 5.5 billion years from now, it will go through its death phase, where it will end its life into something dramatic. What that is what we're going to be learning about in this module. In fact, when we look at different stars across our own galaxy and beyond, we find that it really comes down to three different types of stars. There are low-mass stars, medium-mass stars, and high-mass stars. Our own sun is an example of a medium-mass star. So the mass plays a major role in the life cycle, the evolution of a star. The way I look at it is like an analogy of driving a big SUV. Remember those Hummers? Versus like a Toyota Prius, right? If I were to give each of those vehicles 10 gallons of gasoline, which vehicle is going to be able to travel the farthest on the 10 gallons of gasoline? I think we'd all vote the Toyota Prius is probably going to go pretty far compared to the large Hummer, right? And what do we get from that example? We get that the larger the vehicle, the more mass there is, the faster it burns through the fuel. And that's exactly how we look at stars. Stars are nothing more than a ball of gas that's burning. And depending on the initial mass of that star will determine its lifetime, its longevity of life. Our own sun is a medium mass star. It has a projected lifetime of about 10 billion years. So if you were to dramatically reduce the mass, that particular star, a low mass star, could last for tens of billions of years, if not 100 billion years or more. But if you were to even just double the mass of our own sun, you'd cut the lifetime down to tens of millions of years. So the lifetime of the star itself is purely dependent on its mass. Now, in all of the stages of evolution, there are a lot of similarities. There are only some minor differences when we get to the end phase, the end stage, the death stage of a star based on its mass. All right, so let's walk through this. When we look at the initial stages of a star being born, we need to recognize that there are two dominant gases that exist out in space, hydrogen and helium. Now, hydrogen is the number one gas that exists out there. So here we are. We are looking at what we call a nebula. A nebula is a cloud of gas and dust. And when I say cloud, I'm talking about a huge cloud, something larger than our own solar system. I mean, we humans are conditioned when we think of clouds. We're thinking of the big white puffy things up in the sky that you probably have found yourself looking up and looking at imaginary animals, right? We all do that from time to time. Those clouds are small. And so when I say the word cloud, you might have subconsciously already limited your thinking to that small thing. But I'm talking about something huge. I'm talking about a cloud bigger than our solar system. And inside that cloud of gas and dust, we find hydrogen gas. Now, I mentioned dust. Now, the processes vary and the theories vary. But ultimately, what happens is inside that cloud of gas and dust, we get dust particles that collide and stick together. And the more particles that stick together of dust, you start building up some mass. You start building up gravity. Gravity is a force, what we call an attractive force. Gravity is a force that exists between any two pairs of objects. And under the universal law of gravitation, it says, basically, that any pair of objects that are out in space will attract each other and be attracted by each other. So that means that if I were floating in space, and let's say there is a wrench floating out just beyond arm's reach, we're a pair of objects. That means that I would attract the wrench and the wrench would attract me. Now, however, the force of gravity of an object is tied exclusively to its mass. And we kind of got a feel for that when we talked about the Jovian versus terrestrial planets, right? Jovian planets have tremendously more gravitational forces because they're much more massive than our smaller terrestrial planets. So we already have a picture of that. So as these dust particles start to clump together and gather together, they start building up gravity. Gravity starts to build up and build up and build up, and it starts to compress and squeeze the cloud of gas and dust. And it will start to compress it and compress it and compress it down until the point where you have actually compressed the hydrogen gas together to ignite it in a process called fusion. It's like lighting the fuse. Woo! We ignite the cloud. That's our very official first stage of stellar evolution called the protostar stage. And the protostar stage is basically when we've lit that fuse and you've got gravity that has compressed the cloud, fusing the hydrogen atoms, causing it to burn. Now, some real cool stuff's going on now, because now we've got hydrogen burning. If you've ever watched an action film, right, you've seen maybe in an action film, you've got the good guy walking casually, and in the background, massive explosion, right? And typically what happens in those action films, the good guy flies away, right? What do we notice? We notice that every time there's an explosion, there's an outward force. That ball of burning gas in a protostar, that's hydrogen burning. That's a thermonuclear reaction. That's a thermonuclear explosion. So here's what's going on. You've got an outward force that's being projected outward because the hydrogen gas is burning. But remember, gravity was there to begin with. Gravity is there at the core of that newborn star. Gravity is an attractive force. It's always pulling inward. So now we're at this game of tug of war. We've got gravity pulling inward. Everything's pulling inwards towards the center of the star, but the star is now burning, and it's causing an outward force of energy. At some point, there is enough energy released outward that will balance the gravitational attraction inward. And that gets us to our second stage, a stage of equilibrium, which is what we call a main sequence star. I kind of look at it like this. If we take the football team at the university and put them on one side of the game of tug of war, and let's say we take the chess team. Now, I'm not playing stereotypes. I guess I am, but I'm going to guess that the chess team is not pumping weights every day. So there's going to be an automatic disadvantage, and we get that. But let's say you've got 12 guys from the football team, but you've got 30 guys on the chess team, and you keep adding more and more and more to the chess team. At some point, the game of tug of war won't be so disadvantaged. It will even out. That's what we're looking at here. The hydrogen burning is causing forces to go outward while gravity is pulling forces in. At some point, it equals out, and that's the main sequence star. 90% of a star's lifetime is spent in the main sequence stage. Our own sun is a main sequence star, which is great because we want to wake up every day and our star is doing exactly what it did the day before. You do not want to live and be on a planet next to a star that's either being born through the protostar or going through its death stages. All right, so 90% of the star's lifetime is spent as a main sequence star. Now, this particular star is burning, burning, burning. One of the consequences of burning hydrogen is that you produce helium. So the core of the star is starting to fill up with helium. Helium is not the name of the game. For a star, it's burning hydrogen. At some point, the fuel is starting to run low. So the star, in order to keep burning, has to go towards the availability of fuel. Remember, this ball of burning gas is inside a larger cloud. So what happens then is that the ball simply expands. The layers of burning migrate outward toward the availability of fuel. If I were to leave a trail of lighter fluid and light a match on one side of it, is the match going to stay here and just suck in all the fuel? Or is the match going to burn a fuel, leave a residue, and travel towards the availability of fuel? You're right. It's going to travel down the availability of fuel, right? We've seen that in action films. That's what's happening in a main sequence star. At the end of the main sequence stage, equilibrium is still there. However, you're starting to fill up the core with helium gas. And helium gas is not the name of the game here. Burning hydrogen is. So you've got this three-dimensional sphere, this ball, that starts to expand and get bigger because the layers of burning are migrating outward to get to more fuel. This clicks over to our third stage called the red giant stage. Two things are going on here. The star is getting bigger, so it turns into a giant. And check this out. When you have burning, you are exerting a certain amount of heat, right? When the star gets bigger, you're taking that same amount of heat, that same amount of burning, and you're distributing it over a larger surface area. If you can imagine going from a golf ball to a soccer ball, right? their differences. They're bigger, right? The soccer ball is much bigger. It has a larger surface area, which translates to meaning that the surface area is going to cool down. It's sort of like if I were to take a small piece of metal, about the size of an index card, and hold a blowtorch next to it for 5 minutes. And then I said, here, take this piece of metal. You'd probably say, no, thank you. That's going to burn my hands. Now, if I were to take a large 3-foot by 3-foot piece of metal and hold the same blowtorch for the same 5 minutes to one corner, and I say, hey, can you move this piece of metal? You'd probably say, yeah, actually, I could probably pick up the other end of it. Because you know that that heat would be distributed out across a larger surface area and thus be cooler than it would be if it was distributed over a smaller area. The same happens with a star. When we take the surface area of a small star and we make it bigger, we take the heat, we distribute over the larger surface area, and it distributes out less. So the actual outer surface of the star cools down slightly. Now, when I say cool down slightly, it's still really hot compared to us, 98 degrees here. It's still really hot, but it will change color. It will turn a red color. In fact, if you've ever cooked on a natural gas stove, you've noticed likely that the flame is not the red-orange flames that we see from candles and campfires. It's actually a blue color, right? And what do we know about colors on burning temperatures? Blue signifies a higher degree of burning, a hotter temperature. Red would be technically cooler. That's why you can always boil water faster over a natural gas or propane-powered stove versus over your campfire, because it's just hotter. So when we see something turn red, we know it's a cooler temperature than if something were burning simply blue. So in the third stage of stellar evolution, the red giant stage, it's red because the outer surface has expanded, distributing out the same amount of heat over a larger surface area, causing the outer layer to drop in temperature ever so slightly. And it's a giant because the outer layers of burning had to migrate outward towards the availability of fuel. Well, not everything in space has an infinite amount of quantity. There is a limit, a finite limit, to the amount of hydrogen gas available for that star to burn. All right, so we've got this red giant star, and it has expanded. At some point, it hits the limit of fuel. It reaches what's left of the fuel. There's nothing more to burn. And in a very dramatic fashion, some cool stuff happens that represents the death of that star. Now, all of the stages for every star goes through the same. We go through the nebula, the protostar, the main sequence, and the red giant. Here at the end game is where it differs based on mass. Here are the three possible scenarios based on the mass of a star. For a low-mass star, that red giant will simply flick lights out and collapse. Now, why would it collapse? Because, remember, when the hydrogen is burning, it's exerting a force outward. But gravity is always there at the core of the star, pulling inward. That's the game of tug-of-war. If the chess team simply walks away from the other side of the game of tug-of-war, the red flag in the middle is going to move to one side because gravity is still there. Gravity is still there and left unchecked when the hydrogen burning turns off because it's exhausted the fuel supply. So it simply takes this huge star and it collapses it into what we call a white dwarf. In fact, you can take a star much larger than our own sun and cram it into something smaller than our own moon, and that's about the size of a white dwarf. And it looks white because of the incredible amount of heat that's there. Now, there's no heat source. It's just leftover heat. And over time, it will cool down. It will lose its heat and eventually reach the temperature of absolute zero, which then we'll call it a black dwarf. You can't see it anymore. You can only see things that emit a temperature in space. Now, that's the first scenario. Second scenario is for a medium-mass star. It will collapse and become a white dwarf. But something cool happens when it collapses. Because it's just got enough mass, when the three-dimensional sphere starts to collapse on itself, there is a conservation of momentum that occurs when the two sides of the sphere meet each other at the center. And it translates into causing the thinner, lesser masser outer layers of that star to eject outward into what we call a planetary nebula. For a quick demo, here's what I did in class to demonstrate that with a basketball and tennis ball.
For a medium mass star, the collapse of it will cause a planetary nebula, which is the same thing as modeling with this basketball and tennis ball, and all we have to do is drop it at the same time, and the tennis ball will fly off. One, two, three.
All right, so what did we see? We saw that the tennis ball was ejected out when we dropped the two objects. That's exactly what's going on for a medium mass star. It creates this beautiful ring of cloud-like gases that we call a planetary nebula. Now, the naming convention is unfortunate because the word nebula would imply that it gives birth to something. And planetary nebula, you might think, oh, okay, that gives birth to planets. No, it does not. It does not absolutely give birth to planets. It's just an unfortunate naming convention. Here are some great, cool pictures that the Hubble Space Telescope has captured of such planetary nebula. And check out the center of those. You'll see a white dot. That's the white dwarf.
A planetary nebula is a phase of stellar evolution that the Sun should experience several billion years from now, when it expands to become a red giant. It will then shed most of its outer layers, leaving behind a hot core that contracts to form a dense white dwarf star. A wind from the hot core will ram into the ejected atmosphere, creating beautiful shell-like structures seen with optical telescopes. This gallery shows four planetary nebulas from the first systematic survey of such objects in the solar neighborhood made with NASA's Chandra X-ray Observatory. X-ray emission from Chandra is colored purple, and optical emission from the Hubble Space Telescope is colored red, green, and blue. The diffuse X-ray emission is caused by shock waves as the wind collides with the ejected atmosphere.
All right, the third scenario in the death phase of stellar evolution is for a high-mass star. A really highly massive star doesn't simply collapse. Instead, it terminates its life in a brilliant explosion called a supernova. And a single supernova explosion will release more energy than all the energy combined when that thing was burning hydrogen. That's pretty insane. Massive explosion. A massive explosion called a supernova. There are two outcomes when a supernova happens. Either you have caused an explosion so severe that it has combined electrons and protons into neutrons, and you get what's called a neutron star. Or the second scenario is that gravity is left just completely, insanely out of check, and you have, out of that supernova explosion, created a black hole. So the stellar remnants of a high-mass star is either a neutron star or a black hole, and the stellar remnants for a medium-mass star and a low-mass star are just simply a white dwarf. That, in a nutshell, is stellar evolution. So enjoy exploring the stages of stellar evolution, learning a little bit more about it as you go through this module. I'm Professor Kenny Tapp. We'll see you next time.